For a long time I traveled down a long, lonely road. My heart was so heavy in sin. Then I heard about Jesus. What a wonderful Lord! I'm so glad that I found out He would bring me out through His saving power.
Thank God I am free, free, free from this world of sin. I've been washed in the blood of Jesus, I've been born again. Hallelujah, I'm saved, saved, saved by His wonderful grace. I'm so glad that I found out He would bring me out and show me the way.
Then the door of life's prison was opened by love. The ransom was paid and I was free. To lead. Now I'm free from the fear of tomorrow, and I'm free from the guilt of my past. For I've traded my shackles for a glorious
sins are blotted out, I know. God washed them all away. He saved me by His precious blood. Oh, what a happy day! Oh, I'm free, I'm free. Oh, I know I'm free. God saved me, He died on Calvary. Oh, I'm free. I know He's coming soon. I know not when He will return. It may be morn or noon.
We'll give some folks some time to get on here on Wednesday. Let's see, what's this one here? That's that one. Not that one. Let's see. How about let's play this Anywhere Forward?
Anywhere it forward in the King's highway, to the prize before us, nearer every day, learning more of Jesus and his holy will, never turning backward, never standing still. Anywhere it forward, forward is the word, have you not the captain's orders heard? Anywhere if forward in the King's highway. Anywhere if forward, let the moments bring avenues of service for our blessed King. Work for him is precious, toiling in his might, for his yoke is easy and his burden light. Anywhere forward, forward is the word. Have you not the captain's orders heard? Lead us, Heavenly Father, lead us on, we pray. Anywhere forward in the King's highway. Anywhere forward, step by step we'll go, where his word and spirit shall the pathway show. Forward in his service, in the life of rest, spreading wide his kingdom, useful, glad, and blessed. Anywhere forward, forward is the word. Have you not the captain's orders heard? Lead us, Heavenly Father, lead us on, we pray. Anywhere if forward in the King's highway, anywhere if forward in the
PBC Online, a ministry of Old Paths Baptist Church in Northfield, Minnesota. We are in the Southern Concrete Command Center right here in this lovely building here and in this studio. And We are live during this blizzard that we've got here, and it's a good one. It's going to get a lot worse here as time goes on. So OPBC will be live tonight from the Southern Command Center, the Concrete Command Center here. We'll be doing our, I'll be preaching live here tonight. It'll be on Sermon Audio and on Rumble. I'll put it on both of those tonight. And I usually don't do it on YouTube just because I just like sticking my tongue out at YouTube. I don't like them very much. But anyway, I really don't because I just don't. So anyway, I use YouTube, but I want to build up Rumble's platform. And of course, Sermon Audio has been very good to me over the years. The folks that put that on have been, and so have the people that listen through Sermon Audio. And all that good stuff. So we are going to broadcast the Wednesday evening message tonight from here. So I'll play some music like I do during my broadcasts. I'll play some music tonight here at 7:30 Central Time, 7:30 p.m. Central Time. And we'll start some music at 7:30, give people about 20 minutes to get on there, and we'll have that through, and maybe, I don't know, maybe Andrew will do a private one through, so the chat's on there from, I'll talk to Andrew about it, but if everybody signed up for Rumble, we can do that too, so we'll see. Anyway, I'll figure it out, and we'll go from there tonight, but either way, I'll have Andrew, he can remote commandeer into the computer here, and he can take over, and we'll figure it out and figure out what we want to do like that tonight. But him and I will get that figured out. But I'll play some music here for us at 7:30 and get that started, give everybody 15, 20 minutes. But the driving is horrible. It's not very good out there. It's getting worse out there, actually. And over here, we're getting dumped on a lot of snow. It's pretty, the wind's going to pick up and it's going to be pretty bad. So we're going to take it, be wise, and you know, that's why we have this ability to broadcast, is just in case something happens on, you know, that we can use it for that purpose. And, you know, obviously for all of you out there that get to be blessed by OPBC and the material and the things that we put out. Now, don't forget about, oh yes, and congratulations to Brother Ryan and Erica, brand new baby boy born to Brother Ryan and Erica, and also to Brother Garrick and Paisley. They just had their baby girl. Same day. A new one for Old Paths Baptist Church. Same day. Two on the same day, and there's two more scheduled, I think, for this year. I think it's two. I don't know. My wife, and then Brother Joshua's wife as well. And I think that's it. But if I forget, somebody will let me know. So we really do believe that be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And we're doing it. Amen. Yes. Cindy Nelson. I bought my wife a TV monitor upstairs for when I'm gone on the trip. Boy, they've really come down in price. You can get those things cheap now. But anyway, we bought one for upstairs, and now she can watch the broadcast, and the kids can, and then they'll be able to watch when we're live over in Europe. Well, they might not watch live, might be pretty late, but we're going to try to have some of those live and all that good stuff. So anyway, let's talk about the trip here. Don't forget about our trip. We are headed to Europe, and Brother Bicey and I are headed to Europe Sunday, April 16th. We are headed to Europe, and please pray for our trip. Let's see. YouTube's got the video. Let's see. Let's go over here. Over here. And here's the video.
If you,
Brother Andrew and I did. Exciting times. Brother Joshua and Angela are expecting their fifth child, which is the first daughter that they will have. Praise the Lord that they have. So that's exciting. Here's our Europe evangelism tour. Please pray for us. That's number one. If you haven't watched the video, I'm not going to show it, but if you haven't watched it, go watch the video and you'll know our objectives and what we're doing. I'm going to talk a little bit about that today when I talk about Rome, the mother of harlots. And this is probably not going to be the first, the only broadcast on that. I'm probably going to do another one. I'm going to touch on some of the sites that we're going to go to. I'm going to use that footage later. I'm going to use that for documentaries, for preaching, for other things that the Lord allows, okay? But please consider also, number one, pray. Number two, consider giving to our ministry for this trip. It's not going to be cheap. There's a number of ways that you can give for that. PayPal, salvationpreacher@gmail.com. That's our PayPal address. Cash App, that's another way. Apple Pay, that's another way. Venmo is another way. I just learned that I do Zelle too. That's how Charity, my daughter, says jelly. It's funny how she says that. It's always cute. They always grow out of those, the way they talk like that. Then you always miss it. Olivia used to say things like that all the time. And now she doesn't talk like that anymore. She grew out of that. But Charity calls jelly Zelle. And Zelle is another way that I'm going to have to add this to that, is another way. Someone just sent me money the other day for the trip through Zelle. And that's another way that if you can do that, let us know anyway. But it's spelled with a Z. That's all I know. That's right. That's right. Timmy's infamous Me No Two verses. That's right. Never forget that. I love it. And believe me, I'm not making fun of it either. I like it because it cracks me up. And then you miss it when they're done with it and they don't talk like that anymore. Every single one of them, you miss it. Amos told me that he wanted a tanny tane the other day. And a couple weeks back, and I gave him a tanny tane. So that's what. Look, Carl, don't tell me how to say Zelle. You don't tell me how to say it. All right. You're from Croatia. You don't tell me how to say that. I'm gonna teach you how to talk when I get over there, Carl. That's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna teach Carl how to talk. It'll be a blast. Anyway, so whatever. Selly, that's what he says. It's German. Well, I'm American. I'm not German, Carl. We just tend to dominate things. We don't really care what it's called. All right. Anyway, so that's another way that you can do it. But whatever. You'll figure it out. You can do it the old-fashioned way, and you can mail it to 1030 Highway 3 South, Northfield, Minnesota, 55057. Don't try to mail it to 5557. That's not going to work. 55057. And somebody did, by the way. Yesterday, somebody, well, it came yesterday. Somebody mailed us some for the trip. So praise the Lord. And some people gave some on Monday as well. And we appreciate that. We're excited about what God's going to do. And you'll be blessed by it too as well. And somebody sent me a message and they said, how come I'm glad you get to go and your wife doesn't get to. And they made a big deal about my wife not going. And I just kind of chuckled at it. Basically told her to mind her own business. Among other things. But anyway, so it is kind of funny though about that. And but that's the way people are. They gotta think of something. This is a preaching tour. We're going preaching. I'm already preaching in three or four different spots now as it is, and that's just spontaneous. There's gonna be, well, now it's planned, but that's not counting the spontaneous times that we're gonna do that with. My wife is just fine, believe me. That's right, Andrea. Many men did have to, in the Bible, had to leave their wives for the Lord's work and go off and preach and do the things that they had to do. That's absolutely correct. My wife knows where she's at and where God wants her to be. And to be honest with you, one thing I've done in the ministry, and some people fault that, but let me tell you something. I learned this from Spurgeon about a while back. And a long time ago, it was reaffirmed to me through Spurgeon's writings and things like that as well, that pastors got to take time off. They got to take vacations. They got to get away. They got to spend time with their family. They got to do those things. So I spend the extra money and make sure that I take family vacations every year with my family because of that very thing. Because I don't want to win the whole world and lose my children or my family or my wife. So I take the ministry, to my family very seriously first before I do the ministry at Old Paths Baptist Church, and then secondarily the ministry, the evangelism to you out there. I take it very seriously with my family. I take a lot of time to spend with them and to do different things. And so God has really blessed us and, you know, taken care of us. We've been all over the place. We've been to Yellowstone. We've been to the Grand Canyon. We've been to Rapid City, to Mount Rushmore. And Colonial Williamsburg. That's right, Hannah. That's true. So I have purposely done that. And I don't care who doesn't like it. There are people that say, oh, that pastor shouldn't be doing that. Well, you do what you need to for your family, and I'm going to do what I need to for mine. And that's one of the things that I've done, and the Lord's always provided for that. And anyway, so this year will be a smaller scale. I'm going to take off in... May, at the end of May, probably, when I get back and spend some time with my family and take them for some time, probably 10 days or something like that. But it'll be local. I'm going to go down to Iowa and Missouri and check out some places down there and show them some things down there. So that's what I'm going to do at the end of May and the 1st of June, because after that, from June until November, I am a very busy man, and the men of Old Paths Baptist Church are very busy preaching. From June to November, it is nonstop preaching for us. Weekend after weekend, we take a break one weekend, and then boom, we're on two or three weekends. We're preaching at sodomite rallies. We're preaching at all kinds of places like that. So we do a lot of those things. And we're preaching nonstop. So that's why I take that vacation in May, at the end of May, early June, because I'm preaching for 6 months straight, open air, straight to hunting season. That's right. And then I do hunting for about a month, and then I'm done. And then I, you know, then I'm off to preaching in the doldrums of winter here. And like we're in right now for a while. So it gets pretty busy. We're busy. The guys are preaching. We're away from our family. So I encourage them to take some time off and go take a vacation, spend some time with their family and do what they can and all that kind of stuff. But next year, I want to take my family, if the Lord allows, to Canada. And I want to preach to some folks in Canada and see the beauty of Canada and get together with some folks in Canada. So we're going to see what, and preach up there and see what the Lord will allow. Maybe we'll start a church someday in Canada. Anyway, so we're definitely going to be looking at that. So you pray for us about that, what the Lord would allow there as we look at that. And man, I'm excited anyway about this trip to Europe. And please pray for our paperwork to come back and all that stuff. Pray that that will come back and that we get what we need taken care of, and pray again for the Lord to provide for this trip, to continue to provide, because we got some needs still. They're in the thousands. We need it. Okay. So anyway, but I'm confident. I know the Lord is going to provide for us. He always does. So we're looking forward to it anyway, but, so, we are going to talk today about the mother of harlots, Rome. And I'm going to show you some of the things that I want to see in Rome. Now, David Cloud wrote this book, Roman Catholicism, Past and Present. And it's very good, by the way. And I just skimmed through it and I thought, you know what? I'm going to use this. Yes, that's right, Teresa. That is Spurgeon. And that's who that is. Yep. So anyway, and Andrea, we're going to be down in Iowa. My family is, and Dave's family is probably going to be there too for 2 days. And then we're going to take off to Missouri. But we're going to be around the Quad City area, Iowa City area, and Amana colonies. So maybe your family, your husband and your family can meet up with us or something and say hi. That might be a possibility. We won't be that far from you. I know where you're at, so you're not that far away. I'm sure you would, that my wife would enjoy meeting you as well. So we'll see what we can do. And I'd like to say hi to your husband. I've never met him and or you, but I'd like to see your family and everything like that. That'd be good. All right. So the Colosseum. This is one of the stops that we're going to, Lord willing, make on this trip. And it's the most outstanding structure, says David Cloud. And I'm going to get to doctrine here. I'm just showing you a few stops. Yeah, Becca, you'll enjoy it. You've been down there before, but you'll enjoy it. I like Iowa. The food's good too. Ha ha, I forgot about that. When we're coming through there, I gotta get Dave to have a big old fat pork tenderloin, because you can't go to Iowa without having a big old pork tenderloin. Nobody makes pork tenderloins like Iowans make pork tenderloins. Nobody. In fact, there's a tour that you can take of tenderloins, of eating tenderloins through Iowa. Nicholas, maybe someday, but the only way I go around a beach is when it's cold, because I don't want to take my children around a beach with women in bikinis, and I don't want to see women in bikinis. But definitely, if the Lord leads someday, maybe. You're right, Andrea. You're right about that. Or not Andrea, I'm sorry, Teresa. You're right about that. He had a deep depression and he questioned God. That's all in his book, Spurgeon's book, and you can read about that in The Minister's Fainting Fits. He talks about the depression and things that he went through, and also in his biography, his autobiography, his two-volume set autobiography, you can find about what happened there with the Surrey Garden tragedy. Seven people died, eight people counting the baby in the womb. Yes, I know the church caught on fire and they changed it. Yes, I do know that. I know Spurgeon's history fairly well. Okay, so here we go. Here is the old Colosseum. And it was built by the emperors between 72 and 80 AD. It was completed by Titus, the great persecutor. It was called the Colosseum or the Colossal because of the huge statue of Nero that stood nearby. Its actual name was the Flavian Amphitheater. So anyway, that's one of the spots that we want to go to. It's where the gladiators were. The Roman Forum. The Forum is near the Colosseum, and it contains many other ruins from ancient Rome. Some highlights of these are the following. The Temple of Venus in Roma. The Temple of Antoninus and Faustina. The Temple of Saturn. Definitely one I want to go to. If it's still there. Here's the Roman Forum. Okay. Now we're going to get, this is the lead up, because David Cloud visited these sites and he shows you why Rome is that great city, that harlot city. How fitting, Carl, that El Papa is in the Temple of Saturn, in the city of the Temple of Saturn, isn't it? Saturnalia himself, old El Papa. The Temple of Vesta is one of the oldest temples in Rome, although its present appearance dates to 191 AD when it was restored by Julia Domna, wife of Septimius Severus, the fire sacred to Vesta, the goddess of the household hearth. I just talked to Pastor Mike the other day. He called me. We talked for about a half an hour on the phone on I think it was Monday night. Had a good talk with him. The Arch of Titus. Look how old these are. Man, that's amazing. I haven't had a chance to see them. One of the things about preaching is you don't get a chance to see all these things or listen to what everybody else is preaching, because I got to put my own stuff together and I don't have time to watch it. Once in a while I do. I'll watch it when I get a chance, if I'm, you know, depends on it. So here are some of the other sites here. Santa Maria Sopra Minerva, St. Mary over Minerva Church, is dedicated to Mary and was built in the 8th century on the ruins of the Temple of Minerva, a pagan female deity. See, all Rome does is baptize paganism. That's all they did. That's part of their lure. That's part of the Asbury revival. It's baptized paganism is all it is. All of that stuff. In front of the Minerva Church is an Egyptian obelisk standing on the statue of an elephant. We're definitely going to go see that. Mary is Minerva. This is the Queen of Heaven. This is the paganism of Rome. That's what it is. I want to definitely go here because of the seat of the Inquisition. Santa Maria Minerva was the seat of the Inquisition in Rome. A small church was built there here in the 8th century. In the 13th century, the church and nearby premises were occupied by Benedictine nuns. By 1275, the nuns' house and church were given to the Dominicans, who are a mean, nasty bunch. They were the forefront of the Inquisition. They were Loyola before Loyola was cool. Mean, nasty Dominicans. Ran the Inquisition. Nasty. Filthy abominations. By papal decree, the Dominican monastery at Minerva was designated as the official seat of the Congregation of the Holy Office of the Inquisition. Yeah, Pastor Mike and I talked about that on that Asbury revival. Him and I talked about that on Monday night when he called me. We had a good conversation. There you go. St. Mary Minerva Church was the scene of many Inquisition trials and other wicked deeds. On July 29th, 1498, 230 people who had fled the Spanish Inquisition publicly abjured their heresy before Pope Alexander VI, Rodrigo Borgio, his cardinals, and were marched in procession to Santa Maria Sopra Minerva. This persecution was motivated by the Pope's need of funds to build an elaborate embassy for his son, Caesar Borgio. Look at this. Carl, this is another reason I wanted to go here. On September 8th, 1560, Waldensian pastor and evangelist Jean-Louis Pascal, who had been captured in Calabria in the south of Italy and cruelly treated on his journey to Rome, and during his imprisonment there was brought before an Inquisition tribunal at the Minerva Convent. He was condemned and burned to death the following day. His execution was described in J.A. Wiley's The History of the Waldensians. Standing upon the summit of the Janiculum Mount, vast crowds could witness the spectacle. In front, the Campania spreads out its once glorious but now dissoluted bosom, and winding through it like a thread of gold is seen the Tiber. This is where they put him to death. And he records that. You can read that. In 1563, Pope Pius IV chose Santa Maria Sopra Minerva as the final destination of the solemn procession to celebrate the Council of Trent. Now, if we don't get to the Council of Trent today, we're going to get to it maybe Friday. The Council of Trent is a nasty play. It was a nasty council that, by the way, they have never rescinded. The Council of Trent has never been rescinded. It is still the same today. Nothing has changed. Above all other I've given this history, some of this history, not this one, but some of the history through Martyrs' Mirrors, through Rome, through J.A. Wiley, and some, and I haven't even released those J.A. Wiley ones. I've done about five or six Baptist histories and also J.A. Wiley's that I've not released. In 1572, following the St. Bartholomew's Day Massacre, in which thousands of Protestants were murdered in France, Pope Gregory XIII was so ecstatic that he led a procession to St. Mary Minerva, and after Mass, published a jubilee. It called upon all Christendom to thank God for the slaughter of the enemies of the church lately executed in France. Terrible. This is the site of many of an Inquisition and many of people put to death. It's an important site for Baptists. It's an important site for Baptist history, and it's right there in Rome. The St. Mary Minerva Dominican Convent was where Galileo was tried in 1633 and where on June 22nd, he repudiated on his knees his teaching that the earth revolves around the sun. Well, Galileo was wrong and the Bible is right. Somebody wrote a book called Galileo is Wrong and the Church is Right. No, the church in them is Rome. No, Galileo was wrong. Because the earth is a geocentric. The world is geocentric. God created it to be geocentric. But anyway, that's something that a lot of disagreement comes up on, but that's okay. So all of these things happened right there at that spot. Today, the Archbishop of Westminster is Cardinal Murphy O'Connor, who was consecrated at St. Mary's Minerva on October 20th, 2001. He was co-chairman of the Anglican Roman Catholic International Commission, an ecumenical project that sought to reunite the Church of England with Rome. There you go. The Hindu Catholic priest. David Cloud met a Hindu Catholic priest there. That was weird. The confessional booths are there. I want to see this. The Church of Jesu is the headquarters of the Jesuits or the Society of Jesus. This is Mary casting Luther out of heaven. Here you go. I'm just reading some of your guys' comments here. So, this is an interesting thing right here that I'm anxious to look at. On the right lower side of the monument is a marble statue of the Triumph of the Faith over Heresy by Pietro Legros. It depicts Mary holding a large crucifix and violently casting Luther and John Huss out of heaven. Their names are engraved in the statue. A little winged angel off to the side is gleefully tearing pages from a book. Another book is waiting its turn for destruction. The books could be the writings of the reformers or could be the Bible translations, which were also condemned and burned. I think it's the Bible. On the opposite side of the church is a large altar to the Jesuit missionary Francis Xavier. He was Loyola's partner. The golden reliquary contains his right forearm, which baptized thousands of converts to Rome and India and Japan. Baptized pagans. At the very top of the altar, Xavier is presented as a glorified saint surrounded by angels. Francis Xavier is often included even in Protestant church histories as a genuine missionary, but this is bogus and is evidence of a widespread historic revisionism. No man who preached a false gospel of grace plus works plus sacraments submitted himself as a corpse to the Jesuit to the Pope should be looked upon as a genuine missionary. Right, I agree. Outside of the Jesu church is the Piazza del Gesù. Even on calmest days, the square is said to be gusty with little wind devils blowing about. Well, I believe it, bunch of devils. Mother of all churches, San Giovanni Laterno Church. The palace is the first church of Rome, and Latin inscription on the front says, Most Holy Lateran Church, Mother and mistress of all churches of the city and the world. Here is where the Emperor Constantine authorized the Bishop of Rome to set up a church. The Catholic popes lived in the Lateran Palace until Clement V was forced to move the papal headquarters to France. When the papacy returned to Rome in 1377, its headquarters was moved to the Vatican Palace. Tomb of Pope Innocent III, who was a great persecutor of those who refused to accept Roman Catholic doctrine, practice, and in fact was one of the fathers of the horrible centuries-long Inquisition, is located there. How about this? This is another reason. Carlos Montoya, Rodriguez, Espinoza. This is another reason I want to go here. Many councils and synods and historic events have been held here. In 313, there was a synod to resolve the problem of the Donatist schism. Right straight to the Baptist schism right there. The Donatist churches were seeking to remain pure and strict after the apostolic model, and this was causing schism with the looser, worldly churches associated with Rome. The Donatists were cast out and fiercely persecuted. Yes, there was an edict against the Donatists. There was the Edict of Milan that was supposed to give freedom, and then there was the Edict against the Donatists, which stole all the Donatists' freedom from them and persecuted them. Now, if you'd like to know more about that, go to my teachings from sermonaudio.com. I'm going to go there right now. Let's see. Let's refresh the dashboard. Okay, and we will go to here and we'll look it up here. Here we go. Baptist History 101. All the way down to the beginning. I was on the Donatists for a long time. If you want the history of the Donatists. Okay, so there's a question over here by some. Are there any Roman Catholics that are saved? Well, I believe Babylon is Rome. I don't believe it's a nation. I believe it's Rome. I believe it's the religion of Roman Catholicism. And I believe God is still saving people out of her. I believe people get saved out of Roman Catholicism. They see the truth, they get saved, and they leave and they come out. So I believe that you could see that all through history. In fact, during the time of the Reformation, many people believed in salvation by grace through faith came out of Roman Catholicism. Many that would be in Roman Catholicism would have the scriptures translated in the vulgar tongue, like in Germany. And if you go over to Germany and you understand pre-King James, over in Germany, when Luther was translating the Temple Bible and other manuscripts into the vulgar tongue of the people, that people were reading the scriptures in their own tongue and they were coming out of Roman Catholicism because they found salvation by grace through faith. So God is working on those people and showing them and teaching them the truth. So in that sense, yes, I believe God says, come out of her, my people, and God calls them out of her. And they get saved by the grace of God. But anyway, here you go. Here is a list of a bunch of sermons on the Donatists. I have a bunch more to put on there. So, won't that be fun? So that's what I mean by that. I've made comments early on in my ministry that I thought it was impossible, but God, or that not impossible, but that some were never saved. Well, they're saved out of Roman Catholicism. He says, come out of her, my people. He calls them my people, and God calls them out. So, amazing stuff, really. But if someone claims to be saved and they stay in the Roman Catholic Church, We don't have any reason to believe them. Why would we? Okay, so in 1897, Latyrian was the scene of the Cadaver Synod when Pope Stephen VI had the body of his predecessor, Pope Formosus, exhumed and put on trial. Not surprising, the former pope was convicted of heresy and desecrated. Well, the greatest thing for you and I to focus on, we don't know who's saved. But I know this, if those people that claim to be saved reject the gospel of Jesus Christ, they're not saved. Period. If they reject the gospel of Jesus Christ, then they're not Christians. Period. Doesn't matter what they say. We would say that they're not saved. Because they don't know the gospel. So I don't care what they say. They can say they're Christians all they want to, but if they reject the gospel of Jesus Christ, they're not Christians. If they accept the doctrines of Roman Catholicism, they're not saved. You cannot accept Mary as your mediator and be a Christian. Okay, anyway, so ancient baptistry for immersion. That's David Cloud, and that's a baptistry that was there. The Lateran's obelisk. Listen to this. On one side of the Lateran is an obelisk that once stood before the Temple of the Sun at Heliopolis, Egypt. Erected there around 1500 BC, it was brought to Rome by Constantius in AD 357 and set up at the Circus Maximus. Pope Sixtus V found the obelisk in a swamp, restored it, and placed it at the Lateran church site in AD 1588. Further, the marble and bronze columns over the main altar of the Blessed Sacrament in the Lateran are from the Temple of Jupiter. The Temple of Jupiter. So we see this baptized paganism. We see it. Very present in the city of Rome. The Shrine of the Holy Stairs. These are all pagan things that you're finding in Rome. So really what we're going to start out with is, I mean, we're starting out with is this, the baptized paganism in Rome. And it's what you see here, and that's part of what I'm going to show when I get over there and record all these things and use them and teach on them and help people to understand how this is. Near the Lateran Basilica and the Shrine of the Holy Stairs, which is reputed to contain the steps from Pilate's Judgment Hall, Jesus ascended after he was whipped. The steps were allegedly brought to Rome by the mother of Constantine in the 4th century. So there you go. There's the paganism. Many Catholics climb the stairs on their knees in pursuit of a blessing from God and the promised papal indulgence. At the top of the stairs is an image of Jesus. That allegedly was painted without human intervention. The papal audience, David Cloud said he sat there and he listened, he watched that papal audience. Creepy dude. Creepy Vatican. The Vatican Museum, which contains fascinating history but is spiritually dead. It contains a wide assortment of old pagan statues, heathen gods, goddesses, drunken Bacchus, the many-breasted Diana, Mercury, Apollo, the Nile River god, Minerva, Athena. There's a famous statue of a Trojan named Laocoon, priest of the sun god Apollo, being killed by two serpentine sea creatures. It's located in the octagonal Belvedere courtyard. Pope Leo crowning Charlemagne. The third Raphael room contains a painting of the Mass at Bolsena. The Hall of Constantine depicts Constantine's alleged vision of the cross. Mystery. Babylon. The Great. The Mother of Harlots and Abominations of the Earth. The Borgia, his apartment was built by the Pope of that family, Alexander VI. Singularly reprobate man before he bribed his way to the papacy. He had at least four illegitimate children whom he had made rich through appointments after he was pope. He made his son Caesar Borgia a cardinal when he was only 18 years old. Caesar was an immoral, violent man who had his brother put to death as well as his sister Lucrezia's husband. Alexander held unspeakable orgies in his palace and kept mistresses who were married women. He died of syphilis. He's the fake Jesus. He's the fake Jesus that they put that they put in all the pictures. That's who he is. The Sistine Chapel, a rectangular hall with a barrel vault that gets its name from Pope Sixtus IV. Yep, another Nimrod, that's right, an Antichrist figure. St. Peter's Basilica. Massive place. The pagan obelisk. Obelisk. Yep. It's all their satanic power and their charged objects. That's who they are. Great portico. The Holy Door, the Dome of St. Peter's. This is Peter's Crypt. The Tomb of Pope John Paul II. So we understand the Christianized heathenism and paganism that's there. The Trevi Fountain. Papal hearts and entrails and miraculous icons. Santa Maria in Trivio. Right beside the fountain features a copy of the Mary statue at Fatima. The backdrop for his rosary for the world. Right in front of the fountain contains the hearts and entrails of 22 popes who died in the nearby Quirinal Palace. Their entrails. Yep. That's weird. Santa Maria in Via, in short distance away, is the site of the alleged miraculous appearance of an icon of Mary painted on stone, which was supposedly found floating on water. Well, I believe it. Bunch of pagans. A bunch of devils. The pagan mouth of truth. Synagogues where the Pope blessed the Jews. Mm-hmm. Remember, they have no king but Caesar. Then, of course, there's these other churches. The Bone Chapel. Carl, we gotta go there. Nearby the Triton Fountain is the Church of the Immaculate Conception, underneath which is the Capuchin Cemetery, properly called the Chapel of Bones. This weird place consists of 5 rooms featuring the bones of 4,000 Capuchin monks arranged in various artistic patterns. One room is named the Crypt of the Skulls. It contains an arrangement of perhaps 200 skulls interspersed with other bones, with the complete skeleton of 2 monks dressed in brown friar robes lying separately on either side of the room. Another room is named, believe it or not, the Crypt of the Pelvises, and features a tasteful arrangement of pelvic bones. Yeah. In 1797, Pope Pius VI granted a plenary indulgence to those who visit the Bone Chapel on the first Sunday in October. Just unbelievable. It does sound like Halloween. See, this is their pagan. This is pagan Romanism. This is what it is. It's what they do. It's the death cult. While this is the most extravagant collection of unburied bones in Rome, there are other Catholic churches in the area that have smaller assortments in their crypts, including the Venerable Confraternity of Devotees of Jesus Christ on Calvary and of Our Lady of Sorrows. Yeah, that sounds weird. Mm-hmm. So they have this fascination. Oh, and John the Baptist's head in the Treve Fountain area is named for its famous relic, which is purported the head of John the Baptist. It's in a glass box on an altar in a little chapel on the left side of the building. In the same room is the large image of Mary holding the dead Jesus. There you go. Souls of Purgatory. And lastly, there's a Waldensian church in Rome. And this Waldensian church in Rome, about a block farther away from the river, from the whatever river that is. But though the Waldensians stood for the word of God through the Dark Ages and were persecuted by Rome, they are largely apostate today and have been joined with Rome in the ecumenical movement. Teresa, no, I know they claim that Peter was buried in Rome. There's no proof that Peter was in Rome. Okay, so In other words, there's these other spots of Mary and these churches that lift up Mary all through the city of Rome. San Marcello al Corso, also the chapel dedicated to Our Lady of Graces. See, that's what they do. Where do you see in the scriptures, in the Holy Scriptures, where we're supposed to do that? Nowhere. They have another mediator. All they did was change Minerva. All they did was change Diana. All they did was change the pagan deities of women and change the name to Mary and worship Mary the same way. That's what they do. It's an exaltation of Mary. Exaltation of Mary. This is that great city, that whore city. Santa Maria. All through this city, they have idols. They have worship of Mary. Adoration for Mary. Paganism. Mary can't give you grace. Jesus is the only one that gives grace. Christ is the mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. When you see all these things, you know and understand that this is that pagan city. This is that great whore on the hill. On the seven hills. This is that whore city. And who they describe is not Mary from the Bible. But it is a pagan deity that they have lifted up to godhood. It is Antichrist to the core. Let's look at the scriptures here, what they say. 1 Peter 5:10. But the God of all grace, who hath called us into his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. It is God by Jesus Christ the Lord that does that work. Christ is the one that makes all grace to abound. 2 Corinthians 9:8. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. They ascribe those things to Mary, not to God. They have this chapel of Annunciation, honoring the myth that Mary ascended to heaven and was crowned queen of the universe. The church also, look at this, a plaque says that the chapel was originally dedicated to Saint Anselmo, also called San Sano, the protector from mental illness. So these pagan spots all over Rome represents that wicked city. Consider Santa Maria degli Angeli of the Seven Angels. The church was built through the zeal of Antonio Lo Duca, a Sicilian priest devoted to the veneration of angels. In 1541, he had a vision of a light whiter than snow emerging from the Diocletian thermal baths. The only place in scripture where we see angels appearing as light is 2 Corinthians 11:14, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. On the left side of the circular vestibule is one enters, as one enters the church, is a statue of the Angel of Light, which was made in 1945 and placed there at the end of the Jubilee 2000. It has an appropriately demonic appearance. In the center of the apse is the painting The Madonna of the Angels, which depicted Mary on a throne surrounded by seven angels. She is breastfeeding the infant Jesus and has a massive crown and is being placed on her head by the archangel Michael and Gabriel. The other angels are named Uriel, Barachiel, Salatiel, Jediel, and Raphael. These are all from the Apocrypha books, by the way. Name those angels. The Book of Enoch and other things like that that name angels, other than the ones that God has named in the scriptures. That's the difference. On the right wall of the presbytery at the front of the church is a painting of the Presentation of Mary at the temple. It depicts the apocryphal scene of Mary being presented by her parents to the high priest in the temple. She is said to have climbed the steps alone to present herself to the priest. So in essence, they replace Jesus with the divine goddess. That's what they do. That's what they've done. They replace Jesus with the divine goddess. By the way, that's why the Catholic priests are the most effeminate people you'll find. Very effeminate. And there's a spirit. That's why it's that divine feminine. It's the one that the lesbian writes about in her books, Virginia Mollenkott. Here it is. Here's the manliest dude you or the manliest woman you'll ever see in your life. What it is. See, Virginia Mollenkott, she was on the translating committee of the NIV. And all those are Catholic Bibles. Modern translations are Catholic Bibles. And they replace Christ. They divine feminine. Here she is. Old nasty Virginia. Old nasty stank gross lesbian. Nasty. Nasty. In the words of those guys when we were preaching outside of that transgender event, bad granny. Bad granny. Bad granny. The trans religious approach, right? Omnigender, the divine feminine. I had a cousin that looked just like her. Unfortunately, she died and went to hell. By the way, when I was a little kid, that lady hated my guts. Not her, but my cousin. She was like a second or third cousin. She was like 40 years older than me. Big old nasty mean lesbian. Looked just like her. Looked just like her. Didn't like me either. Then I had a science teacher that looked just like her. And I couldn't stand that lesbian so much that I quit school. I was like, I will not have this dyke to rule over me. I will not have this dyke to rule over me. You can quote me on that. Looked just like her, too. So then because they want to change, they want God to change. And they're going to turn God into the divine feminine. So they just replace Mary and Jesus. We're not even going to double down and talk about that right now. But this is all their churches in Rome. Show me anywhere in the scriptures of any divine motherhood of Mary. No, I wasn't saved back then, Nicholas. I wasn't. I don't know, Hannah. They always find me. She's like, how do they always find you? I don't know. They do, though. Because I'm like that prophet Elijah. That's why. Another prominent statue of Mary in this church is titled Mary, Queen of Peace. Mary is depicted holding the child Jesus with one arm while holding the other out of a sign in a sign of blessing. One of the church's chapels enshrines an ancient icon of Mary titled Salus Populi Romane. The health or well-being of the Roman people. Under the main altar of Santa Maria Maggiore is a relic that purports, to be pieces of wood from the manger of baby Jesus. Pieces of wood from the baby Jesus' crib, huh? Electric candles are constantly lit in front of it. And even in a few minutes, I was there taking photos. He says many people came by to pray and worship. Your idolatry, he says. Outside of St. Mary's major church, Mary is even hanging on the cross with Jesus. Think about that. She's hanging on the cross with Jesus. A large crucifix has Jesus hanging on one side and a crown Mary hanging, holding a baby on the other. The image is located in a parking lot behind a gate that is kept locked and we were not allowed to enter, he said. But we got good photos of it from the sidewalk across the street. We found later that the image is accessible from a side door. This statue depicts Rome's dogma that Mary is the co-redemptress with Christ, that she intercedes for men from heaven and aids in their salvation. Here are the following quotations from the Vatican II Council, which, by the way, never repudiated the Council of Trent. It's never been rescinded. And we'll get to that. We'll probably get to the Council of Trent on Friday. Rome the Great Whore and the Council of Trent. We'll talk about that. See if you and I should be yoking up with Rome if we agree. Right? Let's see. Hang on a second. I was just looking at something. Somebody said something about Charles, and I don't see a Charles on there, so. Oh, Carlos. Okay. All right. I was wondering. I was looking at that like, wait a minute. Who's Charles? Okay. Anyway. So, here are the quotations from the Vatican II Council. Rightly, therefore, the Father see Mary not merely as passively engaged by God, but as freely cooperating in the work of man's salvation through faith and obedience. For St. Irenaeus says, she being obedient became the cause of salvation for herself and for the whole human race. Hence, not a few of the early fathers gladly assert with him in their preaching, death through Eve, life through Mary. This union of the mother with the son in the work of salvation is made manifest from the time of Christ's virginal conception up to his death. That is blasphemy. That right there is blasphemy against God and against Christ, who is the mediator. It is death in Adam and life in Christ. You want to know where the center of feminism is? It's right there. It's in the divine feminine worship. That's where true feminism, it is satanic and it is religious. If you think that feminism movement today is not religious, you are deceived. It is absolutely religious. It is satanic to the core. It's that same spirit of Antichrist. It's that spirit of Jezebel. It's that spirit of the divine feminine. It's that Shekinah, that God's girlfriend spirit. It is the bra burning scream for equality cry that goes out. It's exactly what it is. It's a good one Carl sent me here. My old school King James Bible. King James rumored to be gay, wasn't. Did not translate one word of the King James Bible. Your cool new translation, your cool new NIV, Virginia Mollenkott is openly gay and was the stylistic consultant for the New International Version of the Bible. She wrote a book titled Omnigender, A Transgender Religious Approach. There you go. Pretty clear, huh? Pretty clear what spirit that is. That's right, Brother Garrick. Again, congratulations to Garrick and Paisley. Brand new parents just yesterday. With the Son and the work of salvation is made manifest from the time of Christ virginal. That's a lie, isn't it? Taken up to heaven, she did not lay aside this saving office, but by her manifold intercession continues to bring us the gifts of eternal salvation. By her maternal charity, she cares for the brethren of her Son, who still journey on earth surrounded by dangers and difficulties until they are led into their blessed home. Therefore, the Blessed Virgin is invoked in the church under the titles of Advocate. Now, I want to show you something here. And we're not even going to double down on really talking about Mary. But it shows you the paganism of the city. My little children, these things write I unto you that you sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. See that? The sins of the whole world. The advocate. We have an advocate. What do they call Mary? They're calling Mary the advocate. The helper. The Holy Ghost is called the comforter. The mediatrix. In his general audience of May 7th, 1997, Pope John Paul II said that Mary is the path that leads to Christ and concluded by urging all Christians to acknowledge Mary's providential role in the path of salvation. This is all over Rome, the city of Rome, where the Vatican is. When someone says today that Roman Catholics worship Mary, it's typical for this to be challenged by Catholics. But the Catholic Church itself says that Mary is worshipped. For example, a plaque in the chapel of the Virgin of the Grace at St. Vincent's in Anastasius says, Cardinal Benedetto Odessa, I don't know how to say his last name anyway, who became the Pope with the name of Innocent the 11th. Why are they always innocent? It's amazing, isn't it? Initiated the worship of the image placed on the altar in 1677. And he wanted his heart to be buried here, not in the main chapel. This is only one example that could be given of the term worship used in regard to Mary in Rome's churches. So what we see here all through the city of Rome, we see that Roman Catholic worship of Mary, the exaltation of Mary. We see the death cult. John the Baptist's head. Why would anybody want it? The Bone Chapel. Right? So in this Bone Chapel, it's made of all the bones of all these people. Of the Capuchin monks. What does that do? It glorifies death. This is why Rome. But he that sinneth against me wrongeth his own soul, and all they that hate me love death. The whole city is full of paganism, mixed. You have Constantine, who was not a Christian. You have St. Peter's Square. With the obelisk in the middle. Now, some people put obelisks up for different preachers and things like that. I don't think that's right. But Rome knows exactly where they got this obelisk. They know exactly why they do that. It's been called, it's an organ of the body. It's the male female, okay? It represents the male reproductive organs. That's how I'll say that, because this is a family-friendly broadcast. That is what it represents. So does the Masonic square and compass represents as is above, so is below. The sons of God, the daughters of men. That's what they do. That's what this is. That's why the Masonic order uses them. Let me show you some examples. This is a book. This is how you know they have the same spirit, by the way. Who runs Freemasonry? The Jesuits do. Here we go. This book was written was a French-American physician, philologist, and archaeologist with interest in both Freemasonry and ancient Egypt. The focus of this treatise and the connection between Freemasonry and Henry Honey Church's Gorringe discovery of Masonic emblems and symbols on the obelisk known as Cleopatra's Needle, which at the time of this writing was in hold of the steamship in New York. Okay, so anyway. Here's some of the pictures. The obelisk. Scott, we need to find that book. That'd be a good book for us to find. I have something. I have a really old book on that. Man, I remember it now. It's got red letters on it, and it's a black book. Ah. Hang on a second.
Sitting at the feet of Jesus, this was heard one day. Can a little child like me be saved and learn to pray? This reply was given to the wondering child so small. Let the children come to Jesus, for he loves them all. Too small,
no.
Too small,
no.
Jesus loves them all. Too small,
no.
Too small,
no.
Jesus loves them all. Too small,
no.
Too small,
no.
Jesus loves them all. Let the children come to Jesus, for he loves them all. Doesn't matter what the color, red or yellow be. Precious in the sight of Jesus, all may come, you see. Some with dark skin, some with light skin, he will hear them call. Let the children come to Jesus, for he loves them all. Too small,
no.
Too small,
no.
Jesus loves them all. Too small,
no.
Too small,
no.
Jesus loves them all. Too small,
no.
Too small,
no.
Jesus loves them all. Let the children come to Jesus, for he loves them all.
Okay, I don't know where that book is, but now I want to find it sometime. I just remembered I have it. Anyway, we'll look at that later, but it's interesting to note this. The Masonry Obelisk is one of the three surviving monuments from the Hippodrome of Constantinople. It was located on the spina of Hippodrome towards the southern end of the other two surviving monuments of the Hippodrome. The serpent column is closer, while the Obelisk of Theodosius is closer to the northern end of the spina. Masonry's obelisk is not technically an obelisk, as obelisks originally are monoliths from Egypt and typically are made by the Aswan granite, Instead, this false obelisk is made of limestone, ashlar, and blocks. Well, the interesting thing about this, okay? When you look at this, right, is that because of this, this is a dead giveaway of what spirit they are of because of everything that they follow. I'll have to find that book sometime. It's not on Freemasonry. It's something else. But notice, you remember that obelisk that the Pope had, it came from a pharaoh, right? He said it came from Egypt. It was the obelisk of Egypt, which tells you that Egypt was Babylon. Rome is Babylon. Jerusalem has been called Babylon. But what we know about Babylon now, what you understand about Rome, that great whore of Revelation, it's going to morph into more. Okay? What we know now, it to be now, it will be more, it will be more later. Goodness, I got all kinds of windows open here. All right, where was I? Right here. Because all of the false religions are going to come together under Rome, which is what's happening now as we speak. But Rome has the original, built by the pharaohs, built in Egypt, that is, obelisk. The Babylonian obelisk. Why is that important? Because that's the center of all their satanic power, is Rome. That's the center of their satanic power. That's why they do what they that's what Rome is saying. Okay? And the Masons, they have the same spirit. Now, there were some Southern Baptists that were Masons that weren't right. So I'm not saying that no Baptists were ever mixed in the Masonic order, because some of them were, but that's why we're independent Baptists. It's not all of them are. Amen. But these obelisks, look at the Mason Dictionary. Let's look in it. Oh, they won't let us have it. Well, I wonder why. Here we go. Some of the more fanatical anti-Masons claim the Washington Monument and obelisk is really a secret phallic symbol that is worshipped by Freemasons. It's because it is. The obelisk is, to quote McDowell and Meyer in the Revival Styles of American Memorial Art, one of the most pervasive of all the revival forms of cemetery art. Yeah, sure it is. By the way, the Masonic Order, they give you the, just like the Jesuit order, okay? The same thing as the Jesuit order. The Jesuit order gives you the plain doctrine that they have, their open doctrine, and then they have a secret doctrine. They have a secret that they don't tell anybody. So when you see the obelisk, what it pictures, Freemasons will not tell you the truth in what it pictures. But their secret doctrine will tell you exactly what they believe about it. It's the same thing with the Jesuits. They have a secret order. They have a secret order. And they have secret plans, and then they have open plans. Openly, Roman Catholicism, the papacy tells you they're against Freemasons. Openly, the Freemasons are anti-Catholic. But they all have the same spirit of Antichrist. See, St. Peter's obelisk symbolizes papal supremacy. It stands at the geometrical center of the ellipse and is the gnomon of an immense sundial, symbolizing the sun itself, and alludes to the central figure of the Pope, the Vicar of Christ on earth. Again, the pagan obelisk standing in the center of St. Peter's Square in front of the Basilica was brought to Rome from Egypt in 37 BC. By Emperor Caligula to decorate Caesar's Forum. In 1586, it was moved by Pope Sixtus V to its current location. In an operation that took 4 months and required the labors of more than 900 men, ...75 horses... 40 winches. That's why Rome is the... They're a bunch of harlots, okay? You ready? Why do they have the oldest and most rare obelisk? Why? Because that's other people... Other Masonic orders, other secret doctrine, other occultists, they got obelisks. They don't have the mother of them all. Rome has the mother of them all. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots. You want to know the mother of all secrets? It's Rome. She is the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. There are other harlots Who? Mormonism. Seventh-day Adventism. Anglicanism. Scientology. Pentecostalism. The Charismatic Movement. The Jehovah's Witnesses. Right? They all have this fascination with Egypt. Yeah, let me see if I can get that picture for you. There you go. Hang on. Hold on a second. All right. So, what in the world is Taze Russell? His grave, the founder of the JWs. What in the world is he doing with a pyramid tomb? Look at that. Huh. Well, that's weird. What's a guy want one of those for? Well, he's showing you who he is. Rome. Rome. Same spirit. Same exact spirit. That's who they are. So, why is it important that we show you that? Because Rome is the mother of them all. She is the spiritual mother of them all. She has the mother of all obelisks. Right in her capital. Right in her, by the way, her religious state. The Vatican is a nation and it is the head of the Roman Catholic Church. It is a nation and it is a religion. It is a theocracy. And Rome runs its theocracy through the entire world. Rome's theocracy runs in the United States of America. Rome's theocracy runs in New England or in the United Kingdom. Rome's theocracy runs everywhere through its branches. And all of those people have the same spirit. Same one. And the city, that great city of Rome, where the Vatican is, where the obelisk is. Here's another obelisk, right? That once stood before the Temple of the Sun in Heliopolis. That's the same one, excuse me. Egypt. Erected there around 1500 BC, it was brought to Rome by Constantius. It was set up at the Circus Maximus. Remember what the Circus Maximus was to put the saints to death? Rome is that great whore of Revelation. It's that mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Look what she calls herself. Most holy Lateran Church, mother and mistress of all churches of the city and the world. Well, not Bible ones. But the ones that aren't Bible ones. She is. And they have the same spirit, and their symbols like to show that. There's the obelisk. That's what's in the city. Souls of Purgatory. They have a museum of the souls of purgatory. John Bergen's description of the Mary's cult in Rome in the 19th century is as apt today as then. He said, there has resulted from this unscriptural theory of tradition no grosser perversion of the truth than the entire system of saint worship, and especially the cultus of the Blessed Virgin Mary. She can only be fitly described as a tutelary deity of modern Rome. The Roman Catholic Mary is indeed the tutelary guardian or protector or deity of Rome. You go to the city of Rome and it's guarded by Mary. Not the biblical Mary, of course, but the Queen of Heaven. They celebrate fables surrounding her sinless birth, her presentation in the temple, her assumption into heaven. Consider the Santa Maria in Aura Coli on the Capitolione, which exalts Mary as the altar of heaven. The 124 marble steps, which serve as a ceremonial approach to the church, formerly led up to the Temple of the Sun that was built by the Emperor Aurelian. The site was formerly occupied by an altar to Juno, Jupiter's female counterpart. What'd they do? They just changed it. The main altar features a colorful statue of Mary with a large crown. She is pointing her right hand to a large cross she is holding on her left. In one chapel, there is a statue titled Santissimo Bambino, Most Holy Infant Jesus, a curious little statue beloved of Romans. Any Hindu would love this little idol of an infant god. On the wall facing the entrance to this chapel is the painting Our Lady of the Way. So here you have it. All these temples, all these churches dedicated to Mary in Rome. Why? Because she is that deity. So you have Rome, the Church of Rome, being the female. Who's the male? The Antichrist. Baal's shaft. Right? That's the male-female. That's what that is. Mm-hmm. This is that. Next, we're going to start Is Rome the Harlot of Revelation? And I'll probably title this a little different. I'll change the title around. But we'll start on Friday here. Is Rome the harlot of Revelation? We'll look at what the Bible says, how it describes it. Then we'll look actually at what creatures of old said as well about Rome. And we'll get into a lot of that, but we'll save that for Friday, okay? Anyway, how's everybody doing? I hope you're doing well. Lots of folks on here. We had 55 people on here, and let's see. How do we do on sermon audio? 17 total on sermon audio. If you haven't paid attention to these broadcasts here, if you haven't had a chance to listen to them, Apostasy and Asbury Revival, Asbury Revival, the Feminist LGBTQ Charismatic Awakening. Oh, there's Rome's Circus Maximus. That was on the Super Bowl. We talked about that, didn't we? So anyway, new sermon, The Acid Test of Assurance. That's on there too as well. You can listen to that one. If you haven't listened to that one yet, that'd be a good one for you to listen to. It'd be help you out. Okay. Anyway, all right. Well, let's play a song and you can say hello before we go here. Let's see. Boy, is that wind blowing out there. Let's see.
Nothing to say. They just lost their dearest friend. All that he said, now he was dead. So this was the way it would end. The dreams they had dreamed, not what they seemed. Now that he was dead and gone, the garden, the jail, the hammer, the nails, how could a night be so long? Then came the morning, night turned in, and the stone was rolled away. Hope rose with the dawn. Then came the morning. Shadows vanished before the sun. Death had lost and life had won. For morning had come. Kings from afar, the wedding, the water, the wine. Now it was done, they'd taken her son, wasted before his time. She knew it was true, she watched him die too. She heard them call him just a man. But deep in her heart, all she knew from the start, somehow her son would
faith had lost and life had won, for morning had come. Death had lost and life had won, for morning had come.
All right, amen. Paul from Ireland. Hi, Paul from Ireland. I'm going to be in Ireland. Joe McDonald, tell him when we're going to be in Ireland so we can meet up with Paul. Maybe we can see him there. We'll be taking our trip there, and Brother Joe's going to pick us up at the airport. April, I can't remember what day it is we're going to be there, right after we leave Scotland. And so Joe can let us know, let him know, but maybe Paul can meet up with us over there in Ireland. So praise the Lord for that. Tracy, hope you're doing well. Let's see, Becca, be careful out there in that snow. P.S. Well, I'm glad they're a blessing to you. And how long you been listening? Brother Carl, Brother Scott. Becca Ishida. All right. Brother Paul, Brother Garrick. Maria. Betty. Onya Dika Promise. Fabian. Praise the Lord. Had a good group of people on here today, and hope you're doing good. And we'll be, again, tonight, we won't be having services at the meeting house. I'll be broadcasting live tonight on Sermon Audio and on Rumble from the studio here, because it is nasty out there and I don't want anybody getting into a wreck out there. It's going to be really bad. So it looks like it's getting worse out there, and Joshua said he's seen a ton of accidents. So we just don't want that to, we don't want to take our put ourselves in danger when we don't have to, right? God's given us the means, thank God, to broadcast and to do those things, and we'll just do that. All right, been listening since 2015. Wow, that's a long time. Well, good. About 8 years. Wow. Brother Scott, he's on there. All right. Anyway, but wind tries to jerk you off the road. Yeah, that wind's going to get worse too. So you pray for everybody's safety. And if you don't got to go anywhere, don't go in Minnesota here. You stay home. Shame you're not coming to Wales. Well, can you get out of Wales and can you come over and meet us over in England? I don't think I'm going through there. But anyway, you pray for us, okay? Pray for our trip. Pray the Lord would bless our trip. And don't forget about our video here. Take a look at that video. And if you'd like to support our trip, here's how you do it. PayPal, salvationpreacher @gmail.com. Cash App, right there. Apple Pay, Venmo, all kinds of others like that. Or you can mail it to 1030 Highway 3 South, Northfield, Minnesota, 55057. All right. Thank you to all who are praying for us. And thank you to all who are giving for the ministry and to be able to do this. We appreciate it. We're trusting God for it. We know the Lord's going to provide. And I just remind people how they can do that. Okay. But if you can't do anything, don't feel bad about it. Just pray for us. Okay. Because God will use somebody else. God will answer your prayers. All right. So you make sure you pray for us. That you can do. You can make mention of us. I'm going to be talking about that tonight. making mention of us, all right, in your prayers. Paul talked about that, so we're going to cover that. So you do that, okay? I'm gonna go up and do some walking and some praying inside on the treadmill, do some praying, and then in three and a half hours, I'm going to get back in the studio and preach. But, amen, that's right. We can't get everywhere, can we, Brother Paul? But anyway, God bless you all. Take care. And Lord willing, we'll see you very soon, okay? Pray for us. Live tonight, 7:30 p.m. Central Time. Take it easy. Have a good night. Be careful.